Penguin Random House Canada Audio presents The Agony of Bun O'Keefe by Heather Smith. Read for you by Amanda Arcuri.
Chapter 1. She yelled, "Go on, get out!" So I did. It wasn't easy. The path to the door was filled in again. I tried to keep it clear, but it was like shoveling in a snowstorm. There was only so much I could pile up on either side before it started caving in again. Not that I left the house much. At one point, I had to turn sideways and suck in. I wondered how she did it. She was over 300 pounds. As I inched forward, I saw frozen smiles through a clear plastic bin. Barbie dolls. $10 as is. I knew without looking there'd be some without limbs. I tripped on a lamp and fell on a bike. She didn't even laugh. The only sound was a tick, tick, tick of the bike's spinning wheel. I watched till it slowed to a stop. I took one last look at her before I disappeared behind a mountain of junk. She was nestled into a pile of garbage bags. A cup of tea balanced on her chest, and I wondered, how will she get up without me? Boxes and bags lined the walls. As I squeezed down the hall, I said therianthropy over and over because I liked the way it bounced in my mouth. It was one of the words I said out loud when I hadn't used my voice in a while. It meant having the power to turn into an animal. I'd read it in an old anthropology textbook, and I thought, wouldn't it be nice if my mother could turn herself into a hummingbird? That way, she could flit in and out through the piles of junk that filled every nook and cranny of the house. It was a nice thought, her being a shapeshifter. Maybe, I decided, that's how I should remember her. I walked on our laneway with my arms crossed over my chest. I had forgotten my jacket. I wouldn't go back for it. Not after the trouble it took me to get out. I counted Mississippi's down the long gravel road. By the time I reached the highway, I'd had two coughing fits. She did the trek every day. An empty wagon on the way into town, a full one on the way back. I figured she had exceptional lungs. At the main road, I stuck out my thumb. What I knew about hitchhiking came from the Texas Chainsaw Massacre. It came home in a box of VHS tapes. When I told her we didn't have a player, she said, "There she goes, never satisfied, always asking for more." When I pointed out that I had asked for nothing and was simply stating a fact, she didn't talk to me for days. Months later, a VHS player showed up and I popped in the tape. I watched it on the floor model TV she'd pulled home on a wooden toboggan. It had a missing button, so I had to change the channel with a pair of pliers. The screen had fuzzy lines going through it, which made the movie even scarier. The hitchhiker wanted to kill people. I had no intentions of killing anyone, so I figured there was no harm in sticking out my thumb on the main road. I went to St. John's. Seemed as good a place as any. Only 2 hours away and easy to disappear into. I figured there are places for people like me. People whose mother said, "Go on, get out." After all, there were places for people like Jimmy Quinlan. He was in the box with the Texas Chainsaw Massacre. He drank too much alcohol and lived on the streets of Montreal. Just one of the many derelict human beings in Canada, living their lives around a bottle of cheap wine, rubbing alcohol, or even, on a bad day, aftershave lotion. I watched the documentary so much I'd memorize the script. Alone in the house, I'd recite it. Sometimes I'd say aftershave lotion over and over, putting the emphasis on shave, just as the narrator had. I'd copy his gravelly voice, too. I'd say, "Quinlan's nerves are raw," till I wasn't me anymore. I was a faceless man in the TV. I walked along Duckworth Street and asked the first person that looked like they might know. I waited till he finished his song. "Any missions around here?"
"Missions?"
"Yes. Where alcoholics with no homes go." He smiled.
"You're an alcoholic, are you?"
"No, but I have no home."
"Sorry, I don't know of any missions."
"Are you sure?"
"I'm sure." I must have looked doubtful, because he said, "Why are you asking me? Do I look like a homeless alcoholic?"
He looked nothing like Jimmy Quinlan or the other derelict human beings. For one thing, he had teeth. But he was begging, which is what Jimmy Quinlan did within the first 2 minutes of the film. He stopped cars and people on the busy streets. "Bonjour, monsieur, bonjour, monsieur."
You look like a normal person, I said, but you are begging. He gathered the loose change from the guitar case in front of him. I'm not begging, I'm busking. So you have a home?
I never said that.
So you don't have a home. He fit his guitar into the guitar-shaped space and squinted at me.
Who are you?
Bun O'Keefe. He snapped the lid shut and hopped to his feet.
First time in the city?
Yes.
How did you get here?
Hitchhiked?
You shouldn't do that.
Why not? I wasn't going to murder anyone. He gave me a funny look and headed down a steep hill toward the harbor. He didn't say goodbye, so I followed. When he went into a coffee shop, I stood behind him in line, and the girl behind the counter said, "You two together?" And I said, "Yes." She asked me what I'd like to order, and I didn't know because I'd never ordered anything before. So she suggested tea. I said no in a voice louder than I had meant. I was sick of tea. It's what I drank to keep my stomach from growling. She suggested hot chocolate, and I said yes because I hadn't had one since my father left. My mother called me presumptuous once, after I'd asked her what was for supper. I wondered if I was being that now, so I looked at Busker Boy. But he just nodded at a table and said, "I'll bring it over." I sat on my hands till he came, then wrapped them around the mug. He reached into his backpack and pulled out a thick flannel shirt. When you run away in November, you should wear a coat. His voice was calm and even, like the narrator of Jimmy Quinlan. It was smoother, though, and softer. All the expression was in his dark brown eyes. I put my lips to the mug, letting the steam fog my glasses. I didn't run away. My mother told me to leave. So I did.
How old are you? 12?
14. I read an article about small talk once. It said if you want to create a bond with your conversation partner, you should mirror them. So I said, "How old are you? 12? He laughed. 21. He looked me up and down. "You're small for 14.
Is that bad?
Not at all. Look at me.
I did.
He was short, but thick and bulging with muscles. Stocky would be the word. As long as you're strong, that's all that matters.
Are you strong?
I could shift my mother's boxes out of my way when need be. Yes, I'm strong. He grinned at me.
Your smurf shirt kind of threw me off, too.
It could just as easily have been the Bionic Woman or Starsky and Hutch. Both came home in a box called Vintage. I told my mother that something from a decade earlier couldn't be called vintage. That 70s stuff didn't count. She called me a smartarse and told me to go away. I pressed rewind. My head whirred. Your smurf shirt kind of threw me off, too. Are smurf shirts only for 12-year-olds?
Most girls your age dress way too old, that's all.
Smurf hats are called Phrygian caps. They symbolize freedom. He looked at me like I was making things up, but I don't tell lies. That coffee stinks. A gentle laugh. Who are you? I told you. Bun O'Keefe. I like you, Bun O'Keefe. Once, I stuck a knife in a toaster because my bread was stuck and I felt a jolt. When he said, "I like you, Bun O'Keefe," I felt the same way. It wasn't just a surprise. It was a shock that zinged. They called me weird the year I went to school because I say things that pop in my head. You only went to school for 1 year? Kindergarten. No one said, "I like you, Bun O'Keefe." He said, "That's sad." I said, "Is it?" He stared into his coffee. I said, "Did you know that if you smile, even when you're not happy, your mood will improve? It's a scientific fact." The corners of his lips curled upward. I said, "You look like the Joker from Batman." I liked his laugh. It fluttered like a leaf on the breeze. I took a sip of my hot chocolate. He took a sip of his coffee. I wondered if he was trying to create a bond. I said, "Want to know the difference between a real smile and a fake smile?" "Sure." With a real smile, the orbicularis oculi muscle contracts and makes wrinkles around your eyes. Has that ever happened to you?
I don't think that's ever happened to me.
Lines covered his forehead. I was about to tell him he was contracting his frontalis muscle when he said, "Are you hungry? I can get you a cookie." "Two, please. No ants." His forehead crinkled even more. "Raisins," I said. "No raisins." Alone at the table, I wrapped the flannel shirt tighter around me and leaned forward, letting the steam from my drink fog my glasses. I sat with him under a sign that said Fred's. He gave me a pair of gloves and a hat from his backpack. They were too big, but I didn't say so. He played lots of stuff I recognized from the records.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.